happens. We're just going to get right into it. You know, my co-host and I, Colt, we have talked about this via text. We have not had a chance to talk about it on the show. So let's talk about what everyone's talking about. Jason Aldean and his song, Try That in a Small Town. Now, here's how the conversation started with Colt and I. I had heard about it long before the controversy, if you will, long before he ever texted me. But he sent me a text and it said, so you can just say racist things and have a number one song. To which I replied, well, I don't know that he actually said anything racist in the lyrics. However, one could argue that he's implying it, or one could argue that the video is implying it. Now, didn't say that's my argument. I said one could argue, but people could say that about anything. Here's the biggest issue going into this blind. So if you don't listen to country music, you don't know who Jason Aldean is, you've never heard his music before, you see this video, you hear this song, your immediate visceral reaction is going to be, well, I don't like this. This feels like it's directed at a specific group, and perhaps he might be trying to say something to them in perhaps either a threatening way or a not so threatening way. Depends on how you perceive it. That's the issue there. If you do listen to him and you do know who he is and you do hear this song and you like this song, you take it a couple of different ways. You can take it at face value for what it's saying, which is, don't come to my town. We're a community. We're a group of friends. We have each other's backs. Don't come to my town and try any shit. Now, that's what Jason Aldean tried to say when he defended the song, or he didn't apologize. He, you know, defended himself and the song. And he said, you know, this song was about being a part of a tight, you know, small community where we have each other's backs and nothing goes down. If you haven't seen the video is all about, you know, 30 seconds in, you're going to go, well, this is an anti-protest video. Now, watch it again, watch it more than once, and you should go, well, this is an anti-violence video. The video, not the song. We're not talking about the lyrics of the song, just the video. The video is depicted in a way very carefully where it's very telling to me and symbolic to me that most of the people you see in the video having bad interactions with police, having bad interactions with government officials, acting out, being violent, being, you know, anarchists, if you will, they're white. So that's what people who are defending Jason Aldean are saying. Well, how is this song racist? How is this song about anything other than being anti-violent protests? Five seconds in, I already hate it. But for those of you that listen to the show, know that I don't like country music. Never have, never will. You're never going to convince me to. We won't get into it. And I do want to point out that this, another argument being raised here, and I'll tell you where I stand once we watch this, technically where I stand. A lot of people have raised the argument, well, this was filmed in a town in front of a building where someone was lynched. I think it was like 100 years ago. Does it really matter how long ago it was? I don't know. You figure that out on your own. Whether it matters to me, I don't matter, I guess is what I'm saying. So that's another argument that people are using here. But let's see exactly what's going on. Got some police. Ooh, a Molotov cocktail. Scary.
Sucker punch somebody on the sidewalk. Carjacking old lady at a red light. Pull a gun on the owner of a liquor store. You think it's cool, act a fool if you like. Cuss out a cop.
So a lot of white people so far. But also, how terrible are these lyrics?
Suck a punch on them dead of them on the math mall.
Ugh.
Spit in his face. Stomp on the flag and light it up. We'll try that in a small town. See how far you make it down the road. Around here we take care of our own. You cross that line, it won't take long for you to find out. I recommend you don't try that in a small town.
So the hook of the song, Try That in a Small Town, what exactly, again, through implication, is he trying to say? Is he trying to say that a protest, a violent protest at that, or looting, or anti-police behavior, or anything like that, couldn't happen in a small town? I don't know that I agree with that, because, hey, I'm from a city that just so happens to be located right next to a small town where, boy, did a shit ton of riots go down in that small town. I don't know if you guys have heard of it. It's called Ferguson, Missouri, about 10 minutes away from here. Is that the kind of small town that he's talking about? Because it's not a big suburb, if you will. But how small of a town are we talking here? Are we talking back roads? Who the fuck is going to go protest in back roads anyway? They're going to go where the action is. They're going to go where the businesses are. They're going to go where people will see them protesting. So the whole point of Try That in a Small Town, I'm like, well, how small are we talking?
Got a gun that my granddad gave me. They say one day they're gonna round up. Well, that's...
Ugh. Again with the gun control. Stupid. They're gonna take our guns.
It might fly in the city. Good luck. Try that.
I can't make it through it. So you get the picture. Again, very strategically, 95% white people in that video committing the crimes, protesting, looting, being violent. Something tells me that they expected this backlash. But also, why? Why? What statement are you making? And when was the last violent protest in the United States where why do we need a song and a video like this? Who needs this? Who is this for? Other than country music fans who go, yeah, I don't care if it got pulled off CMT. I don't care. I'm still going to listen. I don't understand. Who is that for? And I did hear a theory too. I don't know. But I heard that Jason Aldean is not from a small town. Let's see where he's from. Macon, Georgia. What's the population of Macon, Georgia? 153,159. What's the population of Ferguson, Missouri? 18,343. That was the numbers from 2021. So clearly, your theory sucks, Jason Aldean. In a town of 18,000, some of the most divisive and historic protests you've ever seen happened there in a small town. Have there been protests in Macon, Georgia? Anti-Semitic protesters demonstrate at Macon Synagogue. Florida man arrested after protest turns unruly outside in Macon. Macon residents gather in support of Temple Beth Israel. So apparently it happens in your town too, Jason. Here's the biggest crime. The biggest crime is, again, I think that song's bad. It's a bad hook. It's a bad video. It's a corny song. But for those that don't know, you want to know how many people wrote this song. And oh, by the way, their names are not Jason Aldean. It took four people to write that song. Four people. What was that opening line? Let's go back. We gotta know what that opening line. I gotta know what it was. Good Lord. This slow walk to the microphone with this terrible jacket and stupid hat.
Sucker punch somebody on a sidewalk, carjacking old lady at a red light.
Sucker punch somebody on the sidewalk. It took four people to come up with that first 22 seconds of that song. Carjacking old lady at a stoplight. Come on, dude. Four people? What happened to one person, two people in the band writing the song? What happened to the artist writing the song? Four dipshits from Nashville wrote that piece of shit song and then signed off on that video. I shouldn't talk shit about the songwriters. They wrote a bad song, and the song's dumb, and the song's message is dumb. The whole thing is dumb.
That's why I think people are getting so upset about it. It's just like, what are we really upset about? Be upset that the crime is this is a bad song and we've done a terrible injustice to the rest of the music world by letting it shoot to number one or whatever it is now. How many records has it sold? Uh-oh.
You know, if it was in Forbes 2 days ago, it's big. Jason Aldean's controversial Try That in a Small Town takes top spot. Top spot on Billboard chart, pushing country music to record-breaking heights. A song with themes about gun ownership? No, he mentions guns once. That's not a theme. Vigilantism? Okay, sure.
That was thrust into the national spotlight when country music television pulled its music video. Which, by the way, what are you doing, CMT? What are you doing? You don't stand by your artist? And for you, Jason Aldean, and other artists, Luke Bryan, I guess that Martian, said, fine, I'm pulling my music. So you're going to, the one platform, the one outlet you have for your dumb music and your dumb music videos, you're going to rally against? How about find a way to get it played? How about coming together as the country music community with CMT and whoever runs that goddamn shit show and find a way to get it played? Come together and talk about, here's what country music is really about. Here's what that song is really about. We didn't mean this. We mean this. Let's all be friends. Let's all come together as a music community. That'll never happen, though.
Pull the music videos made way for country music songs to take the number one, two, and three spots in the Billboard Hot 100 for the first time in its 65-year history.
Try That in a Small Town debuted at number two on the Billboard Hot 100 last week and rose to the top spot this week on August 5th, rounding out a top three chart of country hits Last Night by Morgan Wallen. Luke Combs' Fast Car, cover of 1988 Tracy Chapman hit by the same name. No shit.
The previous week's number one song was Seven by South Korean singer and BTS member Jungkook. Sorry if I butchered that, which I probably did. Drops to number nine. Jason Aldean shot a BTS member nearly out of the top 10 with this song. See what we've done? We did this. We did this. We allowed this to happen.
If we not talked about it, it would have fizzled out and gone nowhere. Because Try That in a Small Town was first released in May but didn't make headlines or the Billboard chart until July when its music video, which includes footage of people protesting police alongside lyrics about gun ownership, not really, mentioned it once, was pulled from CMT.
The song explores the patriotic sentiments of rural areas and implies gun owners in small towns will take it upon themselves to retaliate against people who cuss out a cop, spit in his face, or stomp on the flag. Now, he did say those things. He said cuss out a cop, spit in his face, stomp on the flag. But again, he never said gun owners in small towns will retaliate. What they said here, it implies, which I've been saying all along. We all speak the same language. Through that language, we have implication. The implication is there. Now, if you want to defend it, fine. I'm not going to sit here and defend it because I don't care. It's a bad song with bad lyrics. And in my opinion, coming from a bad genre of music that, to be honest with you, we could go back years and years and years and find songs just like this. This isn't the first one. It won't be the last one. So I think we need to stop talking about it. I'm going to stop talking about it. I'm to blame. Here I am. I helped him get to number one, but it's time to move on. James Hetfield, happy birthday. James Hetfield, believe it or not, is 60 years old today. 60. Do you feel old? Now, I don't come from the Metallica generation that came before me. Now, obviously, I know who Metallica is. I know plenty about Metallica. I like Metallica. But I didn't come from the generation of kids who were rocking Metallica on a regular basis. I had to discover them later. But 60, man. So in honor of his 60th birthday, I'm going to play... Such a good song.
That's the thing. Back then, that tone, those riffs, just how melodic but so eerie sounding they were. Man, that was just new shit to people. People's ears and brains did not know what that was when it came out.
Well, let's get to the birthday boy here singing.
Also, I want to point out, Lars is a goofball, and his drumming gets shit on all the time. But in this song, I can't play drums. Not even close. And I've been in bands with drummers who are insanely good. I think Lars is killing it on this song. Whatever. Those dudes are ripping. Such a good song. Happy birthday, James Hetfield. 60 years old. Leave in the comments what your favorite Metallica song is. I know I picked one that everyone knows. I'm not a Metallica fan unless I pick a deep cut. I get it. Nonetheless, happy birthday, dude. God, that band's so good. One of our favorite sites posted their best songs of 2023 thus far. Now, we're not going to go through all of them because there's been so many great songs, obviously. But you know what's not on here? Is Might Love Myself by Beartooth. They just put out another banger. I know I'm biased, but this band can do no wrong for me. Now, I will say this. The first time I heard it, I was like, okay, yeah, it was cool. Second time I listened to it, I was like, oh, wait. I'm catching things that I didn't catch the first time. And then by the third time, I'm like, this band is great. They can do no wrong for me, in my mind. But for you, Loudwire, to not have that as one of your best songs of 2023 thus far is just criminal. So I am going to make up for your terrible injustice to Beartooth and the metalcore and pop metalcore community. And I'm going to play it now. So there's a part specifically in this song that gets me every time I listen to it. It's a vocal part that I think, like, genuinely Caleb enjoyed the fact that he did it and that he hit it the way that he hit it. That so much that if it was a first take, he was like, holy shit. If it wasn't a first take, he was like happy with himself, which I, as a vocalist, I know what it's like to get in the studio and you have an idea. And then you start singing and that idea just isn't working. So then you're scrambling and you're trying to make up for it. And, you know, sometimes it's a pain in the ass and then sometimes it goes your way. I think this time perhaps it went his way. But no, let's listen to it. Think I might love myself. Rock bands aren't using enough pink these days. And for those of you hating that this dude always has his shirt off now, listen, if you were a dude who had body issues for years and years and years and body dysmorphia and was always concerned with his weight and always thought he didn't look good and you got to look like that, you'd have your shirt off every day, every moment, for every occasion, especially if you're in a motherfucking rock band. I know I would.
Don't know how to take it. Still chasing ghosts, I feel so unsure.
It's a great vocal run there.
And I sold myself a lie. Still gave it one more try. Gave everything that I had and more. Couldn't happen to me. Couldn't happen to me. Couldn't happen to me. Oh, then it took my body over.
Just when you think it's so awesome that they wrote a chorus like that, where they just let the music breathe and they let the vocal take control of the hook. Very simplistic, very, very simplistic, but catchy and, you know, rhythmic, but also complementary to the vocal approach that they took with that. And just when you thought it was like, man, this is really basic. The dueling guitar. Come on. This band's so good.
Changing emotions, we are ranging. I'm out of my cage, breaking my spell. Think I might, love myself. Never be clear, but nothing will change until I face my fear. Done paying the price without knowing the cost.
Just the tone of his voice on those vocal runs is just crisp. It's so good. Here comes the part that I mentioned.
Could it happen to me? Could it happen to me? Could it happen to me? Yeah, yeah. It took my body.
Look, if he knew he was going to hit it, he knew he could hit it, and he still, you know, did the woo. I don't care. That's that. So good. Let's do that one more time.
Me, yeah, yeah. It took my body over.
What a great song. And, you know, the message behind it as well. If you know anything about this band and anything about this dude's struggle with mental health and with depression, you know that this song means a lot to him and is important to him, because he's open about it. I think it's why they have the fan. It's part of the reason why they have the fan base that they do, is because he's so open about it. And look, man, the dude has given compelling speeches on stage about his own mental health. And look, he goes, I'm not here to preach, but here's my situation. So if you know anyone who you think is going through something similar, and it doesn't even have to be close, just remotely similar to this, understand that they need you and understand that you can be there for them. And that's just one little tidbit of the many things that he said. So for him to put out these lyrics in this song, talking about how I'm at a point now where I've been through all of these things, and I think I'm getting better. I'm not there yet, but I'm getting better. That's so important. It's so important, and it just makes me love the band more. So, Loudwire, redo this list. And if you don't redo the list, which you're not because you don't listen to me, the end of the year list, this better be on there. That's all I got to say. So another thing I saw via Loudwire was that, and apparently this is a thing that I already should have, I brought this up to a few people, and they're like, yeah, bro, you didn't know. Apparently Billie Eilish listens to metalcore, So they did an article about it for some reason. She listens or is listening to one of my favorite bands slash, well, I guess the song. Well, yeah, she's listening to the band. It Dies Today. Really good band from the early 2000s. I actually recorded with the producer who produced their biggest record, or the, you know, the record that kind of took off for them in the metalcore world, with a really great song. But this takes me back, man. But yeah, so we actually,
so his name is Tony Gamalo, the producer, but it's off the Caitiff Choir. I never know if I'm saying that correctly. Caitiff Choir. Caitiff Choir is the record. But the producer's name is Tony Gamalo. He's in Cleveland. And we actually picked him because we found out, or because we knew that he did this record, and because we found out that he did a lot of the guitar work on the record, which was at the time was huge for us and to us.
So let's dig into a little bit of It Dies Today. This is from 2004, I believe. This is a Threnody for Modern Romance.
Haircuts. I remember when heavier bands started doing this, and they definitely weren't the first, or the first you would have seen do this, but when heavier bands started doing the dress shirt with the tie, and they would all coordinate colors. The early to mid 2000s was the peak of our existence, in my opinion. Not only for metalcore or rock, but music in general. It's strange going from Beartooth to this and just hearing the difference in the production and the tones and everything. In my opinion, similar sounds, similar bands, but obviously not as similar as I'm probably making it out to be, but the production and sonically speaking, it's just night and day, the difference. Trustkill Records, God, taking it back. I remember the first time I heard that hook, man, I was like, whoa, what am I doing? So many bands, I know so many bands that were trying to pull off that sound, that primetime mall metalcore sound with clean hooks like that, and that style of like, I'm at the peak of my range singing, and
not many could do it like this, I'll tell you that.
Eilish, the mega pop star whose dance-oriented alt-pop incorporates some rock elements, I would disagree with that, but, and who gives frequent winks to metal culture, recently shared It Dies Today 2004 song, A Threnody for Modern Romance, on her Instagram. Good for you, Billie Eilish. You know what? You might be turning around for me. You might be turning it around.
Good song. Good band. Really cool. I think I remember, was it Billie Eilish who was watching Knocked Loose at Coachella? Was it her on the side of the stage, or was somebody else? I think it was her. Nonetheless, good for her. I'm glad you're listening to them, and I'm glad you're listening to metal or rock, who knows.
10 alternative rock songs written under the influence. I saw Disturbed on there, Weezer, Hashpipe, Substances, Ritalin, and Tequila. Yeah, that'll do it. Let's just take Ritalin off the list. Of course Weezer was on Ritalin. For those that don't know, they're one of my least favorite bands. Sorry. I know everyone loves them.
Why don't I love them? I don't know. They just bother me. They always have. I've never liked them. Moving on from that. Tequila and Ritalin. Oasis, Supersonic. The substance was cocaine. Shocking there. U2. Crumbs from Your Table. Alcohol. Disturbed. Fire It Up. They were on cannabis. Beastie Boys, Fight for Your Right. Alcohol. That makes total sense. I'm trying to find one that I... Muse, Plug In, Baby. They were on mushrooms. Okay. Muse, another band that I'm not particularly fond of. Elliott Smith was on meth when he wrote Saint Ides Heaven. Now this we got to see. R.I.P. Elliott Smith. He was 34 when he died. Jesus. Rest in peace. So he was on meth when he wrote this.
Everything is exactly right when I walk around here drunk every night with an open container from 7-Eleven in Saint Ides Heaven.
I remember this song.
Been out haunting the neighborhood, and everybody can see I'm no good. I'm walking out between.
Doesn't meth make you tweak like crazy? Why did he? I'm surprised. Wouldn't it be like a speed metal band wrote a song on meth? It's surprising that that's what was the product of meth, but that song's cool. What else we got? Guided by Voices, Alcohol. The Brian Jonestown Massacre, Going to Hell. They were on heroin. Why don't I know this? I know the name, but I don't know the song. Pretty upbeat for heroin. Now, I don't know what's about to happen, but something tells me I'm going to hate the vocals. Let's see.
I've been out on my own.
Yep.
I've been getting what's mine.
Moving on. I don't know the song Fire It Up by Disturbed. This is from 2015. I didn't know Disturbed were marijuana guys.
No longer run and hide. Will I take a puff from the leaves of the devil?
Man, who in the room hears those lyrics and goes, yeah, dude? Because if I were there, I go, you sure? I'm sure somebody's heard lyrics of mine and been, what the fuck were you thinking? But come on. The leaves of the devil. Come on, dude. You two, I don't know this song. Crumbs from Your Table. From How to Dismantle an Atomic Bomb in 2004. I don't know this song. I'm not a fan of anything YouTube post 96, but sure doesn't. I mean, sounds like you too.
Black is home. You had so much to offer. What did you offer yourself? Something other.
Okay, that sounds like you too.